हेलो, वेलकम टू अमित सिन्हा आईएएस अकेडमी, द वंडरफुल इनिशिएटिव टेकन बाय अमित सर। आई एम गणेश एंड टुडे विल सी मेंस क्वेश्चन दैट वाज आस्क्ड इन 2016 मेन एग्जाम ऑफ जीएस पेपर टू। द क्वेश्चन रीड्स, डिस्कस ईच एडजेक्टिव अटैच्ड टू द वर्ल्ड रिपब्लिक इन द प्रीएम्बल, आर दे डिफेंडेबल इन द प्रेजेंट सर्कमस्टांसेस। सो हियर वी सी that they have asked question pertaining to the preamble of the Indian Constitution and adjectives attached to the word republic. Now, republic itself is an adjective. Anything which adds value or some source, some quality. So, what are the different words? If we read the preamble to the Indian Constitution, we the people of India having solemnly resolved India into a sovereign, secular, socialist, democratic republic. So, sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic, and then republic. So, if we see all these words one by one, we'll understand what is the context in which these words are being mentioned here. So, the first one is sovereign. What do we mean by sovereign? Sovereign means free from outside influence. When a country takes sovereign decision, it implies that the country is acting at its own behest. It is guided by its own national interest. So India, ever since it became independent, ever since it adopted a constitution, has been acting in the capacity of a sovereign country. Our decisions are our decisions guided by our national interest. It's not like we are taking a decision from under the influence of any other country. I'll give you an example. There's this country called Myanmar, which witnessed a coup, military junta. And currently, world is more pro-democracy than ever. So entire world condemned it because a military junta undermines the democratically elected government. And every country started to reduce its ties with Myanmar. India was carrying on the bilateral relations with Myanmar. So the American president, the then American president Barack Obama, asked India that please reduce your ties, reduce your relationship, bilateral trade, and everything with Myanmar. They are having a military junta. The Indian Prime Minister, the then Indian Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh, rightly said that we cannot do that. We have to engage with Myanmar. The reason, Myanmar touches four of our northeastern states. Four of the northeastern states of India, and these four northeastern states are having insurgency. All this insurgency problem, you will study about them in your paper 3, internal security. So whether we will engage with a country which is having a junta or a democratically elected government will be guided by our national interest. So despite world, despite the US having its reservation, India decided to go ahead and engage with Myanmar because we are a sovereign country and our self-interest, our national interest is paramount. Second word is sovereign socialist. Now, socialist actually mean that the factors of production or the means of production are either owned by the government or by the society. See, socialism is an ideology. It's a subset of Marxism. In fact, to be precise, it's the penultimate, the second last stage of communism or Marxism. It's also called dictatorship of proletariat. I'm talking in terms of purist. This is how purists define socialism and communism. But when it comes to India, it had its own version. As C.M. Jodh says, that socialism is a hat which has lost its shape because everyone wears it. So when it comes to India, it was laced with the Nehruvian ideology and we adopted what is called democratic socialism. Now, under democratic socialism, government sector was all pervading everywhere. Comes 1991, India changes the economic policy, India adopts new economic policies under several circumstances, which we are not discussing here, that you will study in your economy paper. So, of course, socialist credentials are diluted as of now, because post 1991, after the adoption of new economic policies, India has adopted a free market approach. There are sectors where private can come in. before 1991, it was not so. There was more of government sector everywhere. Post 1991, we see more of private sector. So this credential stands diluted. It's not done away with, it has become diluted. Third word, secular. See, Indian secularism differs from its Western counterpart. European secularism is different from Indian secularism because Europe had a different history than India. Medieval times for Europe was guided by church, and church used to call all the shots. So whatever church said, the polity was framed accordingly. And it took someone like Napoleon Bonaparte to dismantle the ancient Roman Empire. And he's the one who took the initiative, which the entire Europe adopted. He's rightly called the father of modern Europe, that church shall stay away from politics. So European model envisages a distinction between religion and state, two distinct entities which will function independent of each other. Because Europe was being influenced by religion during all those medieval times. India had a different story. There was no religious domination, there was an imperial domination. So when India became free and we decided to stay secular, although the word was inserted after 42nd Amendment, however, the Supreme Court of India rightly said that though it was inserted through 42nd Amendment, it was always somewhere in the Constitution, implicitly mentioned in the Constitution. So what India said, that no, there will not be a distinct, they will not be a distinct, two distinct entities like Europe has thought up for themselves. Here, as and when needed, states shall interfere in religious affairs. So we see government framing laws against triple talaq. We see sati, that was considered pious, today is a criminal offense because the laws do not allow that. Civilized society do not allow these practices like sati and triple talaq. So we see state coming wherever religion is trespassing over the constitutional values. Second thing of secularism is that India shall not have an official religion. So there is no state religion of India. There are more than 50 Islamic countries in the world. There is a Jewish country in the world known by the name of Israel. There are some Catholic countries. There are Buddhist country. But India is not governed by any theology. India is officially secular. The state has no official religion. India has adopted what is called Sarvadharma Sambhav, which means equal proximity to all religion. The distance that state will maintain with all religions will be equidistant, which again means that India does not abhor nor endorses a particular religion. So this is what the word secular means. So we are done with socialist, sovereign, secular. The other word is democratic. So what does democratic mean? Democratic mean when people choose their representatives. So we are being governed by our elected representatives. This is what simplest definition of democracy is. And what follows up is that there shall be periodic elections. Those elections shall be free and fair, will be governed by an independent constitutional body called the Election Commission. And India has adopted universal adult franchise. Everyone who is an adult, 18 years and above, is eligible to vote. And every citizen of India has one vote, irrespective of his or her credential. So this is what democratic means, that timely elections, free and fair elections under the watchword of, free and fair elections under the guidance of an independent constitutional body called EC, Election Commission. India adheres to the universal adult franchise that anyone who is above 18 is eligible to vote, one person, one vote, irrespective of credential. Whoever you are, whatever you are, you have one vote. So this is what democratic mean. Next, the last word is republic. Now, a republic means absence of blue blood. When I say blue blood, it means royal blood. So wherever there is blue blood or royal blood, it means monarchy. India has no such system. India has adopted republic form of government. The head of the state, that is the president of India, is not a hereditary post. President of India is elected, not by people, but by the elected representative. So he is indirectly elected. That is why we say that India is not a monarchy, India is a republic. Now, Britain is not republic because Britain has monarchy. Britain has a queen and Britain has a prince who will become king. Saudi Arabia, we say Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Prince Salman is there. Bhutan, again. Now, these countries are constitutional monarchies, which means their monarchs are limited by the constitutions. Their monarchs are having a defined role as per the constitution of their countries. India has not adopted even constitutional monarchy because India has adopted republic form of government. The head of the state will be from the people, not hereditary. So these are the terms that the adjectives that are used in the Indian preamble to the Indian constitution. How relevant they are, all of them are equally relevant. When these words were written in the Indian constitution, they stand equally relevant as of now, except for one word, that is socialist. As we have discussed this, that post-liberalization, our socialist credentials stand diluted. Not completely done away with, but diluted. So this was asked in 2016 main exam. And it's a very conceptual question. This is a very, very foundational stage of Indian polity paper 2. And whenever we study preamble, we have to study it. So it comes very handy while studying the preamble to the Indian constitution. This is what I wanted to discuss with you all today. We shall keep meeting each other. Take good care and happy studying.